Thank you very much for the invitation. Jorma would say that it's an honor to separate you from your first coffee break. I'm going to talk about the effect of gravity on quantum states, but let me make some disclaimers first. So I'm really going to talk about not gravity, but acceleration. But since those two, to some approximation, are indistinguishable locally, it's going to be all really the same. And then it's not as general as the title suggests. I'm not going to talk about all possible quantum states, but only a family of Gaussian states. And but the good news is that I'm going to present a formalism that allows you to have exact analytical computation of how any Gaussian state transforms when it's observed from an accelerated perspective, when gravity is taken into account. And one more thing, the study is going to be localized. So the states that we consider are localized, in a sense I'm going to describe. And that's probably, I'll make some comments regarding who wants to talk. And the whole, let me just say that the whole work is a joint project between my group in Warsaw, which involves Mehdi Amadi, my former postdoc, Krzysiek Lorek, who is a PhD student, who will give a follow-up talk on this later on, Agata Chęcińska, who is also here, and she is also my postdoc, and a group, our colleagues from Waterloo, Alex Smith, who is here, and Rob Mann. So let me show you a familiar picture first. This is a diagram that we see a lot. It's a diagram of a uniformly accelerated frame of reference with a slight modification. So here we have a Rindler wedge involving hyperbolas that describe uniformly accelerated relativistic observers. There is a mirror reflected image of that wedge on the other side. And what we have here is an extra separation between those two wedges. And the scheme I'm going to talk about is the following. Suppose that inertial observer prepares locally some quantum state of modes that are localized within those two regions that are marked with red colors. So inertial observer creates some quantum state of those two modes. This state can be either separable or entangled, can be pure or mixed, doesn't matter. And it's localized in a sense I'm going to tell you about in a moment. And the question that we ask is the following. What happens if an accelerated observer goes through that state here and here? What the state the accelerated observer is going to see? And as I said, we have an analytical insight into this problem. We have computed that exactly analytically with no approximations. And we also can introduce an arbitrary separation between those wedges 1 and 2, which allow us to study the effect of acceleration independently on the distance between those two accelerated observers. So in the previous studies, typically people involved, computed a situation where those wedges are merged. I mean, they have a common apex. And that did not allow to study independently separation and acceleration. We can do it within our scheme. So we also can do consider situations where the overlap is when the distance is negative, which means that the two regions are overlapping, as well as a scheme in which those two accelerated observers accelerate in the same direction. So we have covered all these cases. Are there any questions so far? Okay, so let me tell you the basics first. We are working with a scalar massive Klein-Gordon field, 1+1 dimensional, although we can generalize that to 3+1 dimensional cases as well as other types of fields which are subject of the study that we are doing right now. In this case, we consider a scalar field with a canonical scalar product given here. And the familiar Rindler transformation from Minkowski coordinates, t and x, to uniformly accelerated coordinates, chi and eta, with an extra factor here that that is responsible for the separation between the wedges I was talking about. And with those two sets of coordinates, we can take the whole quantum field and decompose it into modes, into plane waves of the Minkowski observer. So we can separate the field operator into positive and negative frequencies according to Minkowski time, as well as decompose the same field operator into positive and negative frequencies according to the uniformly accelerated frame of reference. And the presence of this extra term here means that we'll have to add an extra term to this decomposition. So normally, when D is equal to zero, you have only region one and region two that completely characterize the field. Here, we have an extra region between region one and two. We call it free. And there is some extra component here that also has some decomposition into some solutions of the Klein-Gödel equation. It turns out that for our study, the exact decomposition formula, that the decomposition is completely irrelevant. We don't have to specify even what that operator is. We just know that it's there. But no of the results that we present are going to depend on that component. And what is crucial for this whole approach is introduction of two more possible decompositions of the field operator into modes. So here we have an integral over continuous degree of freedom. For Minkowski observers, we integrate over wave vector. For Rindler observer, we integrate over frequency. But we can also decompose those field operators, that field operator, into a countable family of modes. And we just consider a family of wave packets that is orthonormal, and another family of wave packets that is orthonormal. And the first one is going to be characterized by saying that these wave packets are positive frequency only with respect to Minkowski time. So these wave packets only consist of positive frequency plane waves, while these wave packets only consist of positive frequencies according to uniformly accelerated observer. And we know that those decompositions are not equivalent, which means that there will be a non-trivial Bogolyubov transformation between those two. And now the question that we want to ask is the following. Suppose that the inertial observer prepares a two-mode state of modes that we call phi 1 and phi 2, and all the other modes of that decompositions are in the vacuum state. So the state that we consider is a vacuum state with an exception of two modes that are somehow occupied by an unknown quantum state. And the question we ask is the following. Suppose that the accelerated observer has access to modes psi 1 and psi 2. So only the first two modes of this decomposition. And we ask, what is the state of those two modes, given that the prepared state is a non-trivial state of those two modes seen by the inertial observer? So once again, inertial observer creates some quantum state of two modes. And we ask, what state is seen in those two modes, psi 1 and psi 2, by the uniformly accelerated observer? In general, the other modes of the accelerated observer, psi 3, psi 4, psi 5, etc., are going to be non-trivially occupied, but we discard that information, and we are only interested in the occupation of those two modes, so we trace out over unobserved degrees of freedom. Okay, and what do we assume about those modes? We want them to be localized somehow within the regions that I described, and we want them to contain only positive frequencies of the respective frames. Now, we know very well from, for example, from the talk given by Juan, that those two things cannot be married together. They contradict each other. So if you have a mode that is completely localized within finite region of space, which means it has a compact support, it has to have negative frequencies. There is no other way. It's a basic theorem in Fourier transform analysis. So we cannot have strictly localized modes. So what we do instead is we have modes that are sufficiently localized within the region, but they may have tails that go outside that region. Those tails can vanish pretty fast. For example, this could be Gaussian tails. And so for that reason, our sense of localization is not strict. It's somehow made slightly loose. But this is sufficient to talk about localization in terms of some sort of observations. You have an observer here. You have an observer there. They may be observing a mode that is somehow leaking out from the region, but that that effect is tiny and to some degree could be neglected. Okay, and so our modes are localized. Our modes have to be positive frequency only. And what next? Well, next it turns out that in general the problem of how the state transforms to a new frame of reference is very complicated and there is no known answers. However, there exists a family of states that you can prepare that are very easily treated, and those states, called Gaussian states, can give you a very simple answer to the question that you ask. So if the inertial observer prepares a Gaussian state of his two modes, then it's very easy to show what that state is going to look in the accelerated frame of reference, and let me show you how it works. So first of all, what are the Gaussian states? Gaussian states are very simple objects. These are basically any quantum states that have Gaussian Wigner function. So a Wigner function is, if it's Gaussian, then it's, it can be described with a very, like very simple numbers. Any Gaussian function is characterized by its mean value and width. And since Wigner function is multidimensional in space, in phase space, you have to basically give few mean numbers and few widths of that Gaussian function. And in order to characterize completely a Gaussian state, what you need to introduce is this vector x. So if you have two modes, f1 and f2, you can compose out of those two annihilation operators the following vector of quadratures, which are analogs of position and momentum operators of the mode 1 and mode 2. And then any Gaussian states can be completely characterized by giving the mean value of that vector, so mean position, mean momentum, and all quadratic combinations of those operators, which means average widths in all possible directions. So giving this vector and this matrix, which is 4x4 matrix, you can completely characterize any Gaussian states. And those can involve coherent states, the vacuum, squeeze states, thermal states, or any composition of those. Now, what is very interesting about Gaussian states, and what's very useful for us, is that if you perform any Bogoliubov transformation, whatever it is, on a Gaussian state, and then discard some of the modes, then the state that you end up with is still Gaussian. So this has been proven long ago, and this actually means that if I prepare a state, Gaussian state, in Minkowski frame of reference, then transform it to accelerated frame of reference, remove some of the modes, what I'm left with is still a Gaussian state, so it's still characterized by 4x4 matrix and a four-element vector. So that means that the effect of acceleration can be completely characterized with the following two equations. We have an input vector x of the prepared state and the input covariance matrix of the state that is prepared in the initial frame of reference. And we have an output state, which is basically a state that is observed by accelerated observer that is characterized by those two quantities. And since there must be some transformation between those, we can just introduce a matrix M that multiplies this vector. And then it turns out that the covariance matrix of the output state is given by the following combination of two factors. First, there's a linear term, linear incovariance matrix, plus an extra term that is also a 4x4 matrix. And the good news is that in order to completely characterize our problem, what you need to specify is only those two matrices, M and N. And these are 4x4 matrices. So the effect of gravity, the effect of acceleration on any Gaussian state can be completely characterized by giving two 4x4 matrices. So that really simplifies the problem a lot. We make it even more simple. We consider only states that have no zero mean values. So we take this to be zero. This is zero. This is zero. Then we really have the only thing that we really care about is this equation here. So we only care about the covariance matrix that is non-trivial. Any questions so far about this? Okay, so as you can see, this kind of reminds the picture of a quantum channel where you have an input state, which in this case is a state created by inertial observer, an output state that is the same state seen by the accelerated observer. So we can use the terminology of quantum channels, and we are going to deal with this equation here. So I'm not going to give you the details of the computations. Krzysiek, who will give a follow-up talk, will tell you a bit more about this. I'm going to show you some results. So we can compute this matrix M very easily, and the answer is this. The matrix M is basically a bunch of terms that depend on four numbers, and those four numbers are nothing more but just overlaps, scalar products between our modes, phi1 with psi1, phi1 star with psi1, etc. So those four numbers completely characterize matrix M. So we are almost there. All we have to do is characterize this matrix N, which is also a 4x4 matrix, and having it will provide us complete information about how gravity or acceleration affects our Gaussian state. Okay, so it turns out that N is slightly more complicated, and it relies on three numbers. One we call N1, the other we call N2, and there is an extra number, N12, that is here. And let me first show you what they look like. N1 and N2 are quite simple, so they are given by a simple integral. And it, those integrals have a very nice physical interpretation. So if you look at that diagonal term 1 plus n1, then you can find out that n1 is nothing more but the number of particles in mode 1. So it's the number of particles that the accelerated observer is going to see. And for example, if you consider a vacuum state, so and ask the question how many particles you see in a vacuum state, in the Minkowski vacuum state, when you accelerate, the answer is the following. In the vacuum state, covariance matrix is just unity. So there is m times m transposed plus n. N has the term minus m, m transposed, so these two cancel out. And all you're left with is just this. So n1 is really the number of particles seen by the accelerated observer. And what is it given by? It's given by the overlap between the mode that you observe with a given plane wave of a given frequency times Bose-Einstein distribution, which is basically a number of unruh particles of that frequency. So you look how many, what is the contribution of a given frequency to your mode, then you ask how many unruh particles are in that mode, and you integrate over all frequencies. That's the outcome. The same for the second mode. Now the off-diagonal term, which is responsible for non-local correlations between those two modes, is slightly more complicated. In the limit when d is zero, so when the two wedges meet in a common apex, the expression is quite simple. It's given by the following integral here. So the whole expression would be really simple. However, unfortunately, when d is non-zero, things get complicated or interesting, if you like. And this expression is replaced by this horrible integral that involves Bessel functions of imaginary order multiplied by highly oscillating functions. And this integral is basically a pain to compute. It took us a couple of months to really numerically evaluate those. So the expression is analytical, but to perform those integrations, it takes a lot of effort numerically. However, this is a strict and analytical result. And in principle, it's giving you the complete insight into the question of how the acceleration affects quantum states, quantum Gaussian states. We have analogous expressions for the case where, oh, one more thing. We can prove analytically that this thing vanishes when d goes to infinity, which means that if you are in the vacuum, Minkowski vacuum state, and you have two observers that accelerate, and then you separate them by increasing d, the distance between the wedges, then those terms vanish, those off-diagonal terms vanish, which means that those two observers are not going to see any correlations, quantum correlations in the vacuum state when they are separated. So those correlations somehow, in order to see them, you have to be close, close together. We have analogous, one more remark. Those expressions apparently depend on a parameter A that is here. This parameter is the parameter of the Rindler transformation that I introduced. And I would like to point out, and that's very important, that this dependence is merely apparent. It's only apparent when you perform integrations, the results become independent on the choice of A, which is relevant. It led in the past to a lot of confusion in the community. So that's why I want to stress on this. In order to see this, for example, if you look at this term here, in order to see that it's A independent, what you need to realize is that this overlap here turns out to be proportional. It's of the form 1 over A times some function of frequency over A. Now, if you plug this in here, then you see that all the dependence of this integral is of the form omega over A, which means you can replace integration variable and get rid of the dependence on A completely from that expression. And the same happens in all the other terms. So the results do not depend on the choice of coordinate system. We have also scary expressions for co-accelerating case. I'm not going to go into details. Let me show you some results. Before I go to results, let me briefly tell you how we choose our modes that we consider. So we first choose the modes characterizing the inertial observer. We call those phi 1 and phi 2. And those modes are given by the blue curve. So we somehow take them to be similar to Gaussian's envelope multiplying an oscillatory function. So it results in a wave packet like this. And how do we choose the accelerated modes? We want to study the effect of acceleration, so we have to answer how a given mode would change if I accelerated that mode, whatever it means. And in order to answer this question, we take the example of an accelerating cavity. When you have a cavity at rest, you know what the eigenmodes of that cavity are. So these are basically plane waves, well, or sine function or cosine functions. But when you accelerate a cavity, those sine or cosine functions become slightly degenerate. They become tilted a little bit, and they transform into Bessel functions. And basically, we use the same analogy. We take a mode in inertial frame of reference, and we distort it in the same way as a mode of a cavity would get distorted. And so we are basically ready to answer the questions how, given the choice of modes that I presented here, acceleration is going to affect quantum states. So first question, that is the basically the first question you want to ask, consider Minkowski vacuum. So suppose take the easiest possible Gaussian state, which is basically Minkowski vacuum, and ask, what do accelerated observers see in the Minkowski vacuum? And this is the case when d is equal to 0, when we have two wedges that touch each other. And we ask, what is negativity, which means what is the amount of entanglement seen by the accelerated observer when you change one of the accelerations here, the other acceleration here? So basically, you change acceleration of both observers and see how that affects the entanglement of the state that you observe. And it seems that we get a straightforward result, which is kind of intuitive, that when you increase accelerations, then you get more and more entanglement that you observe. So in the limit of no acceleration, you end up in the state, in the Minkowski vacuum state, which is obviously unentangled from the perspective of the inertial observer. So that's the first result, very trivial. But there is some more very interesting results here. So consider a different situation where you have Minkowski vacuum. You have two accelerated observers that have the same proper accelerations. And we ask how much entanglement they see as you change d, as you change the separation between them. And the result is here. It's the same plot in different scales. This is the full scale. This is zooming. This is just a part of the plot. Have a look here. You can see that when d is equal to 0, you see a certain amount of entanglement. And when you increase d, that amount of entanglement decreases and eventually vanishes within a finite time. With finite, well, for finite d, it vanishes, which is some so-called sudden death of entanglement effect, which means that in order to see entanglement in the Minkowski vacuum, you have to be in a finite distance between each other, at least in this scheme. Now, it gets much more interesting when d becomes negative. So here, d is equal to 0. And when it becomes negative, entanglement also vanishes within finite for finite d. But you see that the behavior of the curve changes completely. So as you change d, at some point, this amount of entanglement starts to oscillate like crazy. And it shows that apparently the structure of entanglement is very sensitive to the Rindler structure of the light cones. So this choice of d equal to 0 is somehow special for the structure of entanglement in the Minkowski vacuum state. And it's highly affected, especially when d becomes negative. Here we have a similar question. In this question, we fix the distance between two observers. So they are separated by a given distance, proper distance, and we change acceleration that they go with. So they are in fixed distance, and we increase acceleration here and acceleration here. We choose those accelerations to be the same. And it turns out that, again, the curve looks like this. Then it finishes here, and then it becomes oscillatory again. So once more, there is a finite range of accelerations for a finite distance between the observers for which you are able to observe entanglement in the Minkowski vacuum. Any questions? Yes.
So these curves are for specific cavity sizes? And
We don't have really cavities here. I only use the analogy of the cavity in order to argue how we want to change our modes. But this is really free field situation. Yes.
So it depends on mass.
Yes. Those results do depend on mass. Yes.
So you took m going to 0.
We have chosen m to be 0.1 here. You cannot take the m going to 0 limit because for uniformly accelerated frame of reference, the massive field and massless fields are qualitatively different cases. You cannot retrieve m equal to 0 case by taking m going to 0 limit.
If you just reduced m, how would the sudden death distance depend?
Depending on m, I don't know. We haven't checked that. But we have all the tools to do it. So, and we do know how the massless fields behave, but this is a separate study. It cannot be obtained by taking m equal to 0 limit, m going to 0 limit. So let me continue. This is a similar picture for a case where two observers accelerate in the same direction. We have similar study here. Again, for d equal to 0, something special happens, and the behavior changes. Whether d is positive or negative, it qualitatively changes the behavior. Now, let me study some more non-trivial case. So let us consider not a vacuum state, but something else in the vacuum state. And a pretty generic Gaussian state, two-mode Gaussian state, can be taken as a two-mode squeeze state of a thermal state. So if you take a thermal state of two modes and two-mode squeeze it, that gives you a quite broad family of Gaussian states that can be either pure or mixed, depending on what n, which is thermality factor here, is. Those states can be also either separable or entangled, depending on what the squeezing parameter is. So we have control over separability and purity of your state with the use of just two parameters. That's the beauty of Gaussian states. They are very simple. So again, this term here dictates how pure your state is. N is equal to 0 corresponds to pure state. Larger n corresponds to higher temperature and more mixedness. While R is the degree of squeezing, which dictates how much entangled your initial state, input state, is. And that state is defined in the inertial frame of reference. Now we ask how the state is going to look when you accelerate through it. And here's the answer. We are looking at the output state, which is the state seen by the accelerated pair of observers, and we look at the fidelity between the input and the output states. So we basically look at the overlap between those. Yes? Sorry? Yes, it's a two-mode squeezed. You have initial modes phi 1 and phi 2. You put them in a thermal state, and then you two-mode squeeze those. Yes, that's a standard inertial observer that just prepares two thermal states of two separable modes and two modes squeezes them. And then now we ask, what do accelerated observers see? That's the answer. The fidelity of the output state, so the state, the similarity between the state on the output and state at the input, can be quantified by this quantity that we call fidelity. It's basically the overlap between those two states in some sense. And that fidelity depends on the choice of the state. So for example, if you take the vacuum state, which basically corresponds to n equal to 0 and r equal to 0, you have high fidelity. So the accelerated observers is going to see almost a vacuum, plus small corrections from the Under effect. But when you increase the two-mode squeezing factor, so if you make your pure state more and more squeezed, the fidelity drops down, which means that the acceleration is going to have much stronger effect on entangled states than on separable states. That's one conclusion. On the other hand, if you increase n, which is basically mixedness of your state, you can see that mixed states are almost the same either from perspective of inertial or accelerated observers. They don't change much. So you can see that you have to squeeze it much more in order to see any difference from your initial state, which basically shows that the states that are most fragile and most prone to accelerations are the ones that are pure and non-local, entangled. So that's basically the study. We have freedom of choosing whatever we really want to look at. We have complete information about the output state. We can compute any quantity that is of the interest. So that means that we can use our tools to study any continuous variable information protocol involving Gaussian states and study effect of acceleration of that on that state, on that protocol. So what we are currently looking at is we are looking at applications of those protocols to specific protocols such as teleportation of continuous variables or dense coding, known in quantum optics. We want to see how much gravity or acceleration affects those protocols. Another question we ask is how those how the whole scheme changes when you change the type of the field. For example, if you take fermions instead of bosons, what changes? That's a standard question that people used to ask for a while, and we want to see how this particular scheme also translates to changes when we consider other types of fields or other dimensionalities. Obviously, you can look at a situation where you have more than two modes. You can ask a question, what happens if you have n modes or maybe infinitely many modes, how the general question looks in that scheme. And eventually, there's another question that we want to ask. It is what happens if you do not observe just a single mode locally, but you just ask a question about the state in general in a given region of space? Let me explain briefly what it means. If you take a single mode and you accelerate it, you see the Unruh effect of that mode, but the number of Unruh particles is really tiny. It's very, very small. And in order to magnify that effect, you may be, for example, choosing to look at more than a single mode. If you look at many modes, the Unruh effect or all these acceleration effects are going to sum up to some degree, and we would expect to see it much stronger than if you just look at a single mode. So we are currently asking questions like that, how to magnify the whole effect. And eventually, let me show you once more the reference to the paper. It's out a few weeks ago, so I encourage you to have a look. Thank you very much. Thank you.